Claims of Identity by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 10 of 27. Crossing Roads of Yokes, T.S. Eliot. T.S. Eliot's East Coker, finished in 1940, represents the element of earth, of the author's final major poetic work, four quartets. Coke itself, contrary to its conventional slang meaning cocaine, actually refers to the black powdery residue of fuel used for a destructive distillation process such as the distillation of liquor. In important ways, the coke of this poem's title represents the cycle of creation and destruction that this poem is, in part, centered on. Detailing the beginning and endings of human history, family, and contemplation, Eliot travels through time and space in East Coker, suggesting by the association of coke, that human society, too, is the residue of centuries of destructive refining through war, migration, and morality judgments. The poem also inspires the reader to be resilient against the backdrop of social and psychological crises such as the onset of World War II against a very real German threat, as well as the sense of spiritual quest which can only come about through extreme piety and humility. The poem lingers with hesitations and doubt, never completely arriving at certainty in terms of religion, history, and culture. This sense of uncertainty, to not presume too much, is one of multiple complex ideas East Coker addresses. There is another important meaning for the poem's title. East Coker is the name of the hereditary village of one Andrew Elio, T.S. Eliot's distant ancestor who first sailed to the present-day United States in 1667. As the poem's first lines suggest, the interconnected cycles of destruction and renewal extend to human biology as much as to human buildings. Across all forms of human identification and civilization, whether social, historical, or archetypal, Eliot fuses his theme to a broad generalization, which he later inverts in My Beginning is My End, 1. This quotation is a direct inversion of Mary, Queen of Scots' final words before her execution, which was ordered by Queen Elizabeth of England. The inversion of her final words is corrected at the close of East Coker, but not before the fantastic ends and beginnings of human psychology and spirituality have been exposed in their weaknesses. In this regard, the final inversion of In My End is My Beginning suggests that the poem itself has undergone a cycle of rise and fall, covering a totality of all that is in between, 211. For example, houses rise and fall, crumble, are extended. Are removed, destroyed, restored, or in their place. Is an open field, or a factory, or a bypass, 2-4. Clearly, there are many agents responsible for the demise of houses in these lines. They can fall, insinuating the devices of wickedness taking over. Houses can crumble, suggesting a kind of weathering which eventually overcomes even the most upright structures. However, crumbling can also be the result of inattention and neglect. Extended, on the other hand, suggests that a correct model has been followed with enough success to warrant a reproduction of useful policies and practices. Furthermore, the last line quoted suggests that replacements are always ready for even the most stately of houses. However, this is not the good kind of replacement. This kind suggests, not a meaningful, but grossly hollow and humanless adoption of space to be filled, with a factory that builds nothing, and a bypass that leads nowhere. The different fates of buildings also suggests a human relationship. In this way, the word house also encompasses the human body as a representative kind. What is the human body but a house where the mind, soul, and spirit dwell? This much Eliot makes clear when he continues the cycle of renewal and destruction regarding buildings, finally turning old fires to ashes, and ashes to the earth, which is already flesh, fur, and faces, 6-7. These products of change indicate that what is outwardly inhuman, like a fire or a house, is, over time, one and the same as human flesh. All things turn into each other, and nothing is ever destroyed completely, as corroborated by the first law of thermodynamics. The inclusion of faces is also tellingly symbolic. By including this word, Eliot intends that the forces of creation are not always pristinely immaculate. Faces obviously shows that not everything humans create is good, but it can be a smelly waste and byproduct of biological activity, in this case, digestion. The first 13 lines of East Coker conclude with an apt reference to Ecclesiastes in the Bible, stating the varieties of time's purposes for living and for generation. For the wind to break the loosened pane, and to shake the tattered arras woven with a silent motto, 10-11, 13. The relationship of these lines to the biblical Ecclesiastes is important because it introduces an important question, which the biblical author and Eliot share: why do we exist? Ostensibly, it would appear that life is vapid and a kind of vain show. However, this implied historical question, attributed to Israel's King Solomon, reputed as the wisest man to have ever lived, is a beginning from which the highest wisdom is attained. In this poem, all directions lead to this question about why and how humans should live. The notion of humility in meditation is important, too, and it is likely that the family motto of T.S. Eliot's family, "Be silent or act," is what Eliot refers to by the silent arras. It could also be a reference to Orah's tattered of foolish men who went the way of Cain. When this poem was written, Eliot was struggling with an unsure path. This path reflects his passion for religion, possibly Jesus Christ, the destiny of the soul, and the temptations of the flesh. Eliot was on a journey and needed to learn some things. While he was writing his poem, Hitler's armies had conquered the majority of Europe, while the majority of other remaining European countries were controlled by fascist or fascist-leaning governments. Britain was in a tight spot characterized by sieges of German bombing raids on Britain, and food and fuel had to be rationed. T.S. Eliot also faced a personal transition in his own life, away from the errors of his younger years, failed marriage, and estrangement of friends. Perhaps because of the new directions in both the world and Eliot's personal life, he considered middle age to be a time of great choice and opportunity. Middle age for him held the opportunity for repentance and trying to be a good person, to correct the misdeeds of a misspent youth. This biographical information provides an insight into the turbulent situation of cosmic creation and destruction, beginnings and endings, and health and sickness in the poem. Returning to the theme of coke, the black powdery substance, it is worthy to note that coke can be reused as fuel until the black powder is exhausted. Likewise, the antiquated language of Thomas Elio, a distant ancestor of Eliot who wrote a book on English etiquette, finds his own words reused and recycled, for example, in Don Singe, signifying matrimony, 30. This middle part of first section of the poem is an obvious portrayal by Eliot of the constant fashioning and refashioning of language and meaning in poetry, very much like the Earth's own distinctive climatic cycles and weather patterns, in the context of humanity's own climactic attributions. The language of dancing, of course, refers to a unique pattern in its own right, as is the idea of etiquette. These archaic lines which betokeneth concord are the same causes and effects of eating and drinking. Dung and death, 34, 47. By intention, whether one likes it or not, all human flesh amounts to the same product and origin, stemming from untidy conditions and uncertain futures. One interpretation of these lines illustrates that the repetition of etiquette, ritual order, growth, and demise, like the patterns of civilizations rising and falling, living and dying, here signified by marriage, is only one proverbial straw to grab at as an attempt to preserve one's identity. A social culture can be preserved by a traditional dance, just as a child can be born from the pattern of wedlock. Ultimately, however, the poem demonstrates most vividly that preservation is futile, only falling again, crumbling again, and giving one place over to the potent symbol of a new one, suggesting both fertility and waste in dung and death. It is a trap that necessitates salvation. The closeness of Eliot's personal history to East Coker does nothing to soften the brutality of his total negation of the permanence of human existence. In fact, the closeness of the title's place to Eliot may have actually caused the poem to become more, rather than less, dismissive of the longevity of human memory and use. Yet existence is not a co-equal term with life, although they are related. The second section, unlike the enunciation of historical and spiritual beginnings in the first section, focuses intently on the disarray of time. If time were a piece of string, the second section would be replete in knots, twists, tears, and razor-thin slices of a once linear fabric. A good example of how Eliot does this is in the perplexity of the speaker acknowledging the disarray of even the most fundamental patterns, the seasons. The speaker asks, "What is the late November doing with the disturbance of the spring? The late roses filled with early snow." 52-53, 58. The speaker's question can seem ironic because spring is usually welcomed for its warmth, renewal of biological activity, and promise maturing into summer. Apparently, the disturbance of spring actually infers no good for the speaker, but rather ill. Figuratively speaking, what good is the promise of spring when the future is known to be dreadful? This is but another attribution of the dark reality of patterns gone haywire. It is the promise of a false spring, the speaker acknowledges, bearing only misfortune for those that are foolish enough to believe in it. In other words, Eliot is arguing that wishful thinking is a bad thing, like an existential act of bad faith. Spring should not be longed for when it is out of order, it seems. For one, wishful thinking ignores the obvious reality, e.g. months, seasons, November. A false spring longed for could represent a sense of false hope that results in only unfortunate consequences for unprepared religionists. The brutal reality of snow in late roses symbolizes this. However, one who can understand rather than merely perceive the confusion of seasons and established patterns, and snowdrops writhing under feet, and hollyhocks that aim too high will be better prepared for all difficulties, whatever they might be, 55-56. On one level, skepticism may be a cautionary virtue. Eliot was as much concerned about his own soul's condition as he was about the condition of the world at war. He boldly declares that the poetry does not matter, 72. How can it? As Eliot reveals, poetry, like any other human-made art or craft, or building, is at best, only a limited value. In the knowledge derived from experience, 83-84. This means that, like houses, human creations are fated to be destroyed and rebuilt. Yet, in a new and interesting way, Eliot extends the futility of monuments like poetry or structures toward the limitation of human abilities. There can be no perfect work of whatever kind, and therefore no poetry that ultimately matters in the capacity of having its own gravity, its own ontological independence, Eliot implies, because, not only does time limit the possible with age and folly, but human abilities are themselves limited. The word matters itself suggests the permanence of matter, as well as its mutability, future transformation. There is a significant moment in the poem when Eliot reaches out to religion, possibly to more than religion, to seek deeper wisdom and a solid foundation to escape the prison he acknowledges. Knowledge, the speaker argues, imposes a pattern, and falsifies. For the pattern is new in every moment, 85-86. The idea that patterns are new while nonetheless repeated ad nauseam throughout the infinity of eternity is a frustratingly simple conclusion of skeptics. This supposition that each moment is new and open means that every moment is vulnerable and open to disease. With such a notion about patterns, the speaker undermines all permanence, even in accepted patterns, which is why the second section of the poem begins with two seasons mixed together. Perhaps for this reason the speaker offers a strange injunction or request to the reader, "Do not let me hear of the wisdom of old men, but rather of their folly," 94-95. Folly is a more humbling and humiliating aspect of the heart's capacity, whereas wisdom suggests acts. Acknowledging folly makes a person small like a child to enter wherein only children may go. In the notion of human folly, as likewise expressed in Ecclesiastes as well as East Coker, the impermanence of time is ever more grossly overwrought in the good things that humans really do adhere to although they be vanity. Like etiquette to form, Wisdom is at best a kind of grasping at stability as manifested in knowledge, experience, and morality. Obviously, these are values among the most problematic of human systems because they are self-justifying systems in many considerations. As Eliot has already pointed out, they too crumble and are replaced by inhumane factories and bypasses. Wisdom in this regard has qualities more like a road on a journey than an end destination. Humility is the answer, says the speaker, because humility is endless. 99. Comparing humility with pride, pride is the exaltation of the ego, which is limited yet puffs up like yeast in dough. In one regard, the ego is perishable, and, in another, experience to be wise is limited. However, Eliot's suggestion about humility being endless is not only directed toward man's relationship with God, but also toward humanity in general. One is reminded of the words of Jesus Christ, who said that he who gives his life shall save it, and he who tries to save his life shall lose it. Thus, one who accepts the earth cycles, however confused or bewildering, can survive while limited to necessities, while those who seek infinite delight in themselves will have none because, although experience is limited, the desire or lust for delight will never be satiated, rather, it would grow to more and more monstrous extremes. The poem's middle third section plunges deeply and starkly into some manner of navel or abyss, which this essay does not presume to explicate fully, but for the sake of time and pages, renders with the remaining sections explicated roughly in the following manner. Section 3. God's injunction to Cain to be still. Repetition of words, words. R equals full being. Death of material self for higher being. Saint John of the Cross something. Section 4. The wounded surgeon is Christ. In perfect verse. People be sicker be healed more. To be empty to be filled. Section 5. The middle road, the midway of years. Years wasted between wars. Do not presume. Home is where one starts from. Old men caught to be explorers. A lifetime element burning the inside. Out in every moment.